nothing shall be impossible. Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God, unstoppable. Nothing shall be impossible. Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God, unstoppable. Nothing shall be impossible. Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God, unstoppable. Nothing shall be impossible. Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God, unstoppable. Unstoppable God, let your glory go on and on. Impossible things in your name, they shall be done. Unstoppable God, let your glory go on and on. Impossible things in your name, they shall be done.
When you try your best but you don't succeed, when you get what you want but not what you need, when you feel so tired but you can't sleep, stuck in reverse, and the tears come streaming down your when you lose something you can't replace, when you love someone but it goes to waste, could it be worse? Lights will guide you home. Well, high up above or down below, when you're too in love to let it go, but if you never try, then you'll never know just what you're worth. Thank you. your bones, and I will try to fix you.
Well, good morning, everybody. Glad you are here for early Mass. It's great to see all of you today, especially all of you who are guests in our church. And this year, one of our goals is to make it easier to get connected, so we have a chance to meet you and get involved in your life as much as you want us to be involved in your life, and to help you get involved into the life of the church. And so it's an exciting year. It's a wonderful time in the life of our church, and we try to evaluate how we're doing and how easy we are making it for people to get involved. And that's why we look at how we do giving, and that's why, I'm not sure what that was, how we do giving and how we do connecting into Bible studies and so forth to make it possible. I think we just lost a light. That's what it was. Okay. Make it possible for you to get connected easier into the life of the church. And so it's great to have you this weekend. I've been doing this a long time. I thought about it this morning. I was talking to Cindy about it this morning. I will be, have been in full-time ministry come May, 40 years in full-time ministry. Isn't that unbelievable? I can't believe that. I was, for those of you doing the math now, I know you said you had to have started when you were like 7, right? Well, thank you for that, but no. And others of you are thinking, well, you should be better than you are by now. But anyway, I get that too. But the point is, I was a junior in high school when I started on full-time ministry staff with my father and in the church that I grew up in. And it's amazing how fast the years go by. But we're still trying to do the same things now that we did then. And that's just to reach people, to get people involved, not only in a relationship with Christ, but into the life of a church. And it's one of the most exciting and dynamic journeys of my life. And it's exciting to see all of you guys here to be a part of what God is doing in this place. Now, we're talking this morning about the process of breaking bad. Now, last weekend, we tried to lay the groundwork for the series by saying that once you become a Christ follower, you understand you have two natures that are competing every day in your life for control. You have an old nature, that's your default settings. That was the nature you were born with. That is the nature, the part of us that is alienated apart from God. And that nature is still within me. There is a draw within me that pulls me away from God constantly. That's why if I pull the oars of my life in, if I kill the power of the engine, if I drop the sails, if I stop trying, my natural drift will be away from God. You don't drift into success. You don't just simply wake up one day and find that you've ascended the top of a great mountain. I mean, you understand that anything you do that is valuable or worthwhile requires daily effort. It requires constant commitment because your default settings, that which is in your old nature, will pull you in a bad way. So we understand when we know Christ, we've been given an infusion of a divine nature. I have now a new nature competing with the old nature. And we said last weekend, the nature you nurture is the nature that dominates your life. So the series is about nurturing the right nature. It's about giving great attention to the new nature that is within you, the life that you have, the potential that you possess, the power that is within you right now. And so we're talking this morning about the idea that this is tied to a process. This is not a one-time, do it and it'll fix it all kind of a proposition. You don't just make a commitment on Sunday morning to the process and give no attention to it, because you have to be diligent, you have to be consistent, you have to be faithful in the process. And one of the guys that I wanted to look at that was very interesting in studying his life, that was very committed to this process, is an Old Testament character by the name of Moses. And what Moses did was some very unique things early on in his journey toward his fame, toward his success, toward leading a million people into freedom. What he did was significant. Moses engaged in a process that brought him great progress. And this is a process that will affect every life in the room if you will commit to it. Now, let me pull up a narrative in Hebrews 11, and let's look at it. It's a snapshot from Moses' life. Now, let me give you the background. As most of you know, the story of Moses, how that Pharaoh had sent out an edict that all of these male children should be put to death. They're going to be fed to the crocodiles in the Nile River. What a terrible proposition. Well, Moses' parents, Amram, his father, Jochebed, his mother, said, not our boy. This is not happening to our kid. I mean, you may say this is not going to happen. And so what they did is they built this little waterproof crib that could float, and they would hide him every day in the bulrushes down on the Nile. And while Jochebed and Amram would go to work, their daughter, Moses' older sister, would watch over him to make sure he was safe. One day, in the sovereignty and plan of God, Pharaoh's daughter came to this part of the Nile to bathe herself. And there, as you know the story, discovered the baby floating in the waterproof basket. And immediately her maternal instincts kick in, and she just falls in love with that baby boy. She said, I know my father's edict is these Hebrew children should be put to death, but this is not going to happen to this one. Well, Miriam, the older sister of Moses, rushes to the scene and says, I know the perfect babysitter. I know the perfect nanny that would be great for this child. And in the providence and sovereignty of God, Pharaoh's daughter consents to allow Moses' mother, biological mother, to raise him, to be his mentor, to be the one who would pray over him and teach him about the one true Jehovah God, yet raise him in the palace of Pharaoh. So Pharaoh paid the freight for Jochebed to be able to raise her child in the palace. And so it's a beautiful story of the providence of God. There's a great moral to the story in that God has a way of using imperfect people. God has an incredible ability to draw straight lines with crooked sticks. God can use anyone to accomplish anything that he desires to do. So with that backdrop, you notice the verse says in chapter 11, verse 24, by faith, Moses, when he'd grown up, and that's what happens to kids, isn't it? They grow up. Eventually they grow up. When our kids were little, people would come up often at church and say, oh, you need to enjoy them. They're going to grow up so fast. Before you know it, they're going to be, you know, out on their own. And we'd think, oh, this is never going to happen. You know, you feel like when you're in the trenches that it's just, you know, you're just two steps forward and three back. Not that we didn't enjoy every moment of it. Don't misunderstand what I'm saying here. I'm just saying that when you're a young family, you feel like everything's going in slow motion. But wow, one day, you know, they're going off to prom. One day, you know, they're going off to school. They're going off to, you know, start a career. And all of a sudden you realize, I'm now the old guy. What just happened here? What just happened to me? This just went by in warp speed. It's amazing. Kids grew up. Happened to Moses. He was raised in palace of Pharaoh, raised by his mother, Jochebed, and there came a time when he grew up. And notice what happened when he grew up. He realized, I got to make some choices. I'm going to have to decide about my future. Now, he had the influence of his mother. He had the influence of Pharaoh, but he had to choose. As we're going to see this morning, no one could make those choices for him. He had to choose for himself. So here's what he chose. He said, I'm going to refuse to be known any longer as the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Instead, he chose to be mistreated along with the people of God, rather to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a short time. So he made a choice, as we're going to talk about in just a moment. And he went on, the Bible goes on to say, he regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as a greater value than the treasures of Egypt, because he was looking ahead to his award. He was a wise enough young man to see the big picture. He was a wise enough young man to know if you're building your future, you don't just live in the moment. You need to, you know, to be in the now, but you need to have your eye on the prize. You need to have a goal. You need to have ambition. You want to be going somewhere with your life. And here's the secret of that. Understand that. It took Joseph 13 years to ascend to the place that God had for him. 13 years. 13 years of disappointment, 13 years of setback, 13 years of the pit and the prison before he ever got to the palace. There's no such thing as an overnight success. It just doesn't happen that way. You have to work hard. You have to want it. You have to believe in yourself and the purpose of God in your life. If no one else in the world believes in you, you have to go for it. You have to stay after it. Don't give in. Don't give up. Don't give out. And that's the theme. And so Moses was focused on this. He said, I'm looking ahead to something greater than this. So by faith, he ultimately leaves Egypt. He didn't fear the king's anger. He persevered. See that word? Persevered. Don't give up. Don't give out. Don't give in. Persevered because he saw him who is invisible. He said, God has a purpose and a plan for my life. It's bigger than what I've experienced, and I believe in it. I'm going for it. Well, there are at least four principles in that passage I want to point out to you, and we'll go home. The first thing I want you to notice about Moses that got him engaged in the process is he defined his identity. He defined his identity. He knew who he was. He understood how God made him. He made a conscious choice to embrace his identity. He chose not to be known as the son of Pharaoh, but instead to be identified with the people of God. Ladies and gentlemen, there comes a time in your life when you grow to a certain place, because the key to that was when he was grown, he got to a certain level of maturity. He got to a certain place in life. He had this epiphany where he made some choices that would impact his life. And he defined his identity. He said, there is something I want to be known for. There is someone I want to be known as. He said, I'm no longer going to live according to the edicts of Pharaoh. I don't want to be known as a son of Egypt. I want to be known as a son of God. I'm going to nurture the new nature. I'm going to pursue a new passion. I'm going to follow after Jehovah God. And he made a conscious choice to define his identity. You know why a lot of churches, why a lot of people who look at a lot of churches and they don't have a lot of faith in the churches is because a lot of churches, and remember, a church is made up of Christ followers. So when you say church, you're talking about us, is that a lot of churches are schizophrenic. There's a difference between being neurotic and being psychotic, you know. Schizophrenia is a neurosis. If you're neurotic, you're afraid of birds. If you're psychotic, you think you're a bird. So there's a difference. Churches can get neurotic. Churches can be a little schizophrenic in the sense that we act one way when we're in here that is totally different than we act when we're out there. And our friends see that, particularly our friends who don't know God. And they don't understand that. They think that's weird. Because out there, we're this guy, but in here, we're this guy. That's a halo, by the way. You know, and they know the real guy. And they're looking at us like, what's wrong? You just morphed into something weird. I mean, in a lot of churches, we don't even speak to one another in here the way we speak to one another out there. You know, my tradition was we call people brother so-and-so and sister so-and-so, but you sure didn't do that at Walmart, you know. Hey, brother so-and-so, you know, on aisle 14 over there, right? And so what it did, it kind of created this weird neurosis where you think, I get my church on Sunday, but I disengage and I'm somebody else on Monday. Look, the secret to this is consistency. The way to fight this spiritual neurosis is to make a decision to find your identity and say, there's not a secular me and a sacred me. There's only a sacred me. I'm all in for God. I'm going to make up my mind this year, I'm going to put him first in my life. I'm going to define who I am. I'm going to yield to my new nature and resist every day my old nature. There's a great verse in Ephesians 1:6, where the Apostle Paul, writing to the Christ followers at Ephesus, he said, God has made us accepted in the beloved. That's identity. Do you know, can I define your identity in one word? Accepted. You've been accepted. God has accepted you. In fact, the Apostle Paul said, he, Jesus, has made us now accepted. And who are we? We're children of God. That means there's nothing you can do for God not to love you. There's nothing you can do for God to reject you. There's no sin that you can commit that he will not forgive you. There's no place you can go that he cannot rescue you. So when you begin to understand that, you begin to rest in that identity. It takes the fear away. It takes the doubt away. If I'm secure in my relationship with God and I'm secure in who I am, let me tell you how Ephesians 1:6 works. He said, he has made me accepted in the blood. Let me break that apart for you. The first thing you have to do is you have to accept the fact you have been accepted. You have to accept the fact you have been accepted. God has accepted you. You say, I invited Jesus Christ in my life, but I just don't know if he really did. He did. I asked him to forgive me, but I don't know if he really did. He did. He did. Don't rely on your feelings. Rely on the facts. And the fact is, you've asked him and he did. You're not doubting you. You're doubting him. And understand, he's faithful. He can't lie. So accept the fact you've been accepted. Okay, now stay with me on this one. So I accept the fact that I've been accepted. So the second thing I have to do now is accept my acceptance. I accept my acceptance. Okay, God, I accept the fact that you have accepted me. That's how it works. God has accepted me, so I accept that. Now, once I've done that, I can accept myself. Now I'm okay with who I am. I'm forgiven. I'm a child. I'm not perfect, but I am a child of God. I've accepted the fact he's accepted me. I've accepted that acceptance. Now I've accepted myself. Now here's the fourth one. Now I'm free to accept you. I'm free to accept you. You know why people don't accept other people? It's because they've never accepted themselves. And the reason they've never accepted themselves is because they've never accepted God's acceptance. And the reason most of them hadn't done that is they hadn't accepted the fact that he wanted to accept them. So if you can accept the fact he wants to accept you and accept that acceptance, then you can accept yourself, and then it frees you to accept other people. Is that clear? Okay, good. So we'll make sure I'm communicating. 40 years, you ought to get this down, right? Okay, anyway. He defined his identity. I'm accepted. God loves me. He's forgiven me. I know who I am. I'm the Son of God. Secondly, once he defined his identity, now he accepts responsibility. He says, look, here's what I know. There's going to be some repercussions because of my decisions. He doesn't blame his mother. He doesn't blame his father. He doesn't blame Pharaoh. He's a big boy now, so he owns his own stuff. Here's what an immature person always does. An immature person always blames everyone else for everything else that happens in their life. That's immaturity. We expect that. I've got grandkids. I understand that. He did it. She did it. I get it. You know? I mean, that's what kids do. Kids are going to be kids, right? We all get that. And by the way, there's nothing wrong with kids being kids. I mean, we celebrate growth in their life. We want that in their life. But you know, at 20 years old, you probably shouldn't be wearing pull-ups anymore. You probably should own your own stuff. You probably ought to say, I'm responsible for this. And so my point I'm making is, with this defining of my identity, it requires me now to accept responsibility. I'm gonna have to make some big boy decisions, and I'm gonna have to own them. And when you get to that point in life, there's two things you realize. Number one, you can't blame anyone for the direction of your life. Like, you hear this guy, well, my mother wouldn't give me sweets after 10 o'clock at night, so that's why I'm an axe murderer, you know, or something like that. No, you can't. Look, here's the deal. People can hurt you and me. People can scar you and scar me. And everyone in the room has been hurt, and everyone in the room has been scarred. Please hear me on this. No one can ruin your life, though, without your permission. Don't give anyone that power over you. As bad as things have happened, and people I talk to all the time, and I talk to people, some bad stuff's gone down in their life. I get that. But let me tell you something. Don't empower the person who hurt you or abused you. Don't give them the permission or the power to ruin your life, to control your life. You say, you know what? I'm going to take responsibility for me. I'm going to live according to a vision I've got that's bigger than the experiences that I've had. I'm going to walk with God believing he's got a purpose for me. And so as I am defining who I am, I'm also going to accept responsibility for what I do. Another caveat to this is I can't live off of other people's commitments. I can't live off of other people's commitments. Cindy can't be spiritual for me. My wife can't read the Bible for me. She can't do my praying for me, though she prays for me. You get the difference. No one can eat for you. No one can drink for you. They may drink because of you. No, it's another thing. No one can drink for you. No one can eat for you. Now, here's a pretty cool thought. Wouldn't it be amazing if somebody could exercise for you? Oh, my gosh. There's your million-dollar idea right there. You're welcome. Right there. There it is. Figure out a way to benefit from somebody else exercising for you. Here's what I do. I'd pay them as much. If I had to sell something to pay them, I'd pay them. I'd get the biggest bowl of Bluebell and I'd watch them. I'd just sit there going, you know? Wouldn't it be awesome? Just go with me on that for a minute. Just have a little fun. Wouldn't that be cool? Just eat your Bluebell while they're on the treadmill. You go, oh man, come on. 3 miles? We're doing 4 today. Wouldn't that be so awesome? But anyway, it doesn't work that way, right? If I'm going to benefit, I have to commit to it. I can't warm my hands on somebody else's fire. I have to do this for me. And Moses realized the fact, I can't blame myself for where I am in life. I can't use the hardships of my life as an excuse anymore from not going forward. I can't live off of other people's commitments. I'm a big boy. I'm going to define my identity. I'm going to accept responsibility. Let me give you a third thought. Third thing you did when you look at this narrative is he determines his priorities. When you look at verse 26, there's some interesting comments in there. I don't know how your translation may have it. Sometimes it's regarding. He regarded one thing. Other times it uses the word valued. But it's a mathematical word in the Hebrew. It means to weigh one thing against the other. It's like working through a problem. He made a value judgment. He said, I'm going to determine what's important to me. Now, I've given this to you for a while back, but this is so important. Let me give this to you again. If you do not establish the priorities of your life and for your life, if you don't do that for you, someone else will. You will live off of the priorities you establish, or you'll live off the pressure other people exert. If you don't say, this is what is important to me, other people will pressure you and you'll end up trying to be a people pleaser. You'll go around making everybody happy, and at the end of the day, you're the most miserable guy in the world because you're not living according to priority, you're living according to pressure. You're reacting all the time. You never act, you react. You just go around putting out fires all the time. And you just go around, you know, as the old saying goes, everybody's, you know, urgency has to become your emergency. And you're the guy that has a little light and you just pop that on top of your head, little sirens going off and you're running every time somebody calls. And you're going to, I'll tell you something, I've done a little of that. And you're going to be the most miserable person in the world because you have never really established priority for yourself and you're responding to the pressures other people put on you. Now, sometimes that has something to do with how we were raised. Sometimes that has something to do with some of the experiences of life. But I'm saying when Moses was grown, and I'm saying you got to get to a point in life where you see what I'm talking about. And once you've gotten there and you see what I'm talking about, where you see, I've been doing this for so long, I'm not going to do this anymore, it'll revolutionize your life. Now, I can give you, if you're a Christ follower, I can give you at least 4 priorities biblically that I can support. The first priority of your life ought to be God. Now, not God in relationship to your religion, but God in relationship to your relationship. God if you don't have a church. God if you never went to church. But you ought to have him. Start where the Bible started. What's Genesis 1:1? In the beginning, God. Great place to start. So first and foremost, God. So he's first in my life. Secondly is your family. What was the very first institution God established in the garden? The home, right? The family, the spouse, the kids. That was the important thing. I have God. I have my family. The third thing was his career, his job. What did he say to Adam? Take care of this place. I've created a perfect world. Take care of it. Be a good steward of my world, of my environment. Take care of it. And so that was his job. That was his work. It's what God told him to do. The fourth thing God did was he established a form of worship. This is the way I'm to be worshiped. And so worship ought to be a part. You need church, but you need it in its proper order. You need church in its proper place. Now, after 4, you could say friends. That could be 5 for you. I mean, I don't know. Just make it work for yourself. But here's how that works practically. When I get pressured to do something that's going to affect the top 4 priorities of my life, I just tell them to take a number and stand at the back of the line. You know? I'll get to it, provided it doesn't affect one of these priorities. If me doing something for someone else affects my relationship with God, I have to tap the brake. If me doing something for someone else hurts my family, I tap the brake. If me doing something for someone else is going to negatively impact my career, my job, my ability to provide for my family and support my church, I tap the brake. If me doing something for someone else is going to negatively impact my church, I tap the brake. And you just have to realize every whine and every complaint you hear from people, because when you start living this way, you're going to hear whines and complaints, because you're giving them a new you to respond to. They've been used to the you that jumps every time they ring, that responds every time they text, that rushes every time they call, and now you're not doing that. Now your meter, your give a rip meter is not moving. I have one. Do you have a give a rip meter? Some people doesn't even move my needle. You know what I'm saying? I've just done so much. I look at them like, if the Holy Spirit of God can't change you, who do I think I am to fix you? As the song said, I can't fix you. I said, I can, but I can't. I can't fix you. There's some people that only God can fix. So release them, resign from them, allow God to work in them, and you do you. At the end of the day, I'm responsible for me. What does Romans 14, 12 say? So every one of us shall give an account of ourselves to God. I'm not going to give an account of some of these people that pressure and whine and criticize. I'm not going to give an account for them. I'm going to give an account for me. I love what Ed Young Sr. down in Houston told me years ago. He said this, and he was talking to a bunch of us pastors. This works in business too, so apply this to your world. But he said it to us because it's church world. He said he believed that in every church, there were at least 17 kooks. 17 kooks. Kooks, crazy people, okay? Now, you probably work with at least 17 kooks. Stop and think about it. You have about at least 17 crazy people you work with. Come on, don't lie. You're in church. You know, 17. He said, here's what you do. He said, every time they need you, you run. Every time they push you, you jump. Every time they whine, you respond. Every time they complain, you apologize. He said, you end up living your life trying to appease and please 17 kooks. And he said, ultimately, it'll kill you. They'll kill you. You die. You'll die an early death. They'll wear you out, wear you down. And he said, then you'll get to heaven, and God will look at you and say, well, you're here a little early, earlier than I'd planned. And he said, God will put his arm around you, walk you over to the edge of heaven, say, look down there. See those 17 people? They're as crazy as they were the day you met them. You didn't do a thing in the world to help them. I've been working on them for years. Who do you think you are to think you could fix them? I don't know. For me, that was a great moment to hear that. I don't know who I said that for out there tonight, this morning. Maybe you needed to hear that. I don't know. I just felt led to say that. And I'm just simply suggesting to you that when you live according to priority, it changes. It changes a lot of how you respond to stuff. We make ourselves miserable sometimes. Free yourself of that. So I've got people in my life I've recognized I can't fix. You know, I pray for them. I just pray for them. I didn't let them completely. I just pray for them. I've turned them over to the Lord. I can't. I'm willing, but I'm not without you prompting, and so I'm going to pray for them. What would he do? He determined his priorities. This is what I can't get where I'm. I'll never get to Egypt if I don't determine priorities. What did Paul say? All things are lawful, but not all things are expedient. Paul said, I have the freedom to do everything and anything I want to do, but if I'm going to get where I'm going, I have to focus on what I ought to do. Let me tell you something. If you have goals, you can do anything you want to do, but if you reach your goals this year, you have to focus on what you ought to do, because you'll get so busy doing what you want to do, you'll miss what you ought to do, or you'll get busy doing what you can do that you'll miss what you should do. So focus on where you're trying to go. But the expedient, Paul, it's an interesting word. It comes from the word, we get the word expedition from that word, expedition. Did you know no mountain climber has ever ascended the summit of a great mountain and looked at his friends and say, I don't even know how we got here. How'd we do that? Dude, we were just out walking around one day and then we ended up on top of the mountain. How'd that happen? No, every mountain climber has trained for that. They've worked for it. Man, they've sweated. They've spent money. A lot of them have been injured in the process, but they kept getting up and they kept climbing. They didn't give up. They didn't give out until they finally reached the summit. Man, that's what happens when God puts a dream in your heart. It all hell will come against you. Everything in the world will fight you. And the closer you get to realizing that, the stronger the headwinds are. But you persevere. Do you remember the word in the text? He persevered. He didn't give up. Why? He was a man who defined his identity. He was a man who lived according to priority. Here's the last thought, and we'll go. Thirdly, he chose his authority. The Bible said he saw him who was invisible. He chose his authority. He said, as for me and my house, as Joshua would later say, we'll serve the Lord. God is going to be first in my life. He's going to be foremost in my life. He's going to be the authority of my life. He chose his authority. And ladies and gentlemen, I have to tell you, somebody, you're going to work, serve for somebody. As I've said, there are two natures, but you know there's three spirits? Let me really confuse your theology now. You've got an old nature and a new nature, but there's three spirits out there competing for control of those natures. First of all, you have a human nature. You have your own nature. You have your own spirit. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 6, glorify God in your body and spirit, little s, not big S. When you see a big S in the Bible, capital S, that denotes Holy Spirit. When you see it little s, that denotes your spirit or another spirit. So glorify God in your body and little s, spirit, that means your attitude. It's another way of putting that. That belong to God. So I have an attitude. You have an attitude. So we have a human spirit. Not only that, there is a Holy Spirit, right? And the third one is there's a hellish spirit. There's an evil spirit. So what I have to do whenever I choose my authority is I determine which spirit I'm going to yield to. I've got my own spirit, my own attitude that kind of drives me sometimes, but I have to yield to the Holy Spirit. I have to reject the hellish spirit because that will determine which nature I begin to nurture. And I want to tell you again as I close, you know, second time I've said this, you know, I'm really honestly closing now. Whenever you do that, you follow the process, you will discover how God will begin to change your life and begin to bless you. You'll find a deeper sense of joy, a greater sense of meaning and purpose when you are a person that lives according to this process. Let's pray together. As I close in prayer, I want to pray specifically for two groups of people. I want to pray for those of you this morning who've never trusted Christ. And then I want to pray for those of you this morning who have trusted Christ, but you haven't really been living according to these principles. I want to pray this is going to be your greatest year yet. And then after I get through praying, I want to slip out a little early as Rob closes the service to give a chance to meet some of the newest people we have in our church. And so in a moment, I'm going to give all of you guests. And if you brought someone with you, I just want to, I'm not going to keep you. I'm going to be out in the lobby. I just want to say hi. I want to shake your hand. I want to get a chance to meet you. In a big church like this, sometimes we don't have that opportunity. So I'm going to slip out a little early so I can get out there to do that before we close. We'll be out of here in about 3 minutes. So let me pray over you and then I'll slip out. Father, thank you for the people in this room. Thank you for those first and foremost in this room searching. Father, help them to realize it's no accident they're in this room today, that you brought them here because there was a reason, a purpose for it, that you wanted to say to them, you love them and you want to forgive them and you want them. You want to accept them. So this morning, I pray for that person who's never trusted you that this would be the moment when they say right now, Lord Jesus, forgive me of my sin. I accept you. I accept the fact that you've accepted me. And I want to resolve that today. And for others in this room, Lord, who know you but haven't been living according to these principles, I pray something may have been said that will revolutionize their life and family and business. Father, I pray you will bless them and guide them and guard them. And Lord, give us the tenacity, the perseverance we need to be the people you've designed us to be. And God, we'll give you thanks and we'll give you praise. Now, would you just stand with me this morning as we prepare to close? Just go ahead and stand. If you're a guest or you brought a friend, I'd like a chance to meet you. So we're going to ask you to slip out early. I'm going to slip out with you. So if you're new to the church, you've never joined, and you don't mind me having that opportunity to meet you, I'd love to be able to do that. I'm going to slip out now. Rob will close. We'll be out here in 2 minutes. Thank you.